Hello, I'm Dr. Katherine Horton. I'm making a short set of videos about the crimes that are being committed against me and other victims by the intelligence agencies. And what I thought I'll do for that is I'll split my testimony into several separate videos, so you can select which of the videos you would like to watch, what information you'd like to access. And what I'm also going to do is I'm going to make my statement under oath. And the idea is that if you're a victim and would like to use an expert testimony or the testimony of another victim in court, you should be able to use these videos. So I'm using the English oath as it conforms with the Oath Act 1978. And this should be recognized. It's recognized by the English court. So the idea is that other courts should also recognize it. And so my sworn testimony I can be bound by, and it's to the best of my knowledge. What I'm going to use is the witness affirmation. There are two versions of the oath. One of them is the religious oath in the UK courts, but you can also use the neutral witness affirmation if you're an atheist or you just want to have the neutral oath. The two are exactly identical. One is not better or stronger than the other. You're equally bound to say the truth, you know, in a court of law under both. So I'm using the witness affirmation. You can Google that, as prescribed by the Oath Act 1978, which is still binding in the UK courts. So I do solemnly, sincerely, and truly declare and affirm that the evidence I shall give shall be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. So as I said, I'm Dr. Katherine Horton. I was born in Transylvania, which is part of Romania. My parents are ethnic Hungarians and Germans. In the mid-1980s, we fled communist Romania to Germany. I completed my entire school career in Germany, and I skipped year 9 on merit, came top of my year, which allowed me to go to Oxford to study physics. So between the years 2000 and 2004, I was at Hertford College in Oxford. I finished with a first class Masters of Physics. After that, I did a PhD. In Oxford, the name for it is DPhil, but it's exactly the same. And my PhD was in experimental high energy physics. After that, I became a fellow, a research fellow at St. John's College, Oxford. And I was there between the years 2008 and 2012. And part of my research was, for example, at CERN, but I also worked at the German accelerator laboratory DAISY in Hamburg, which is the German electron synchrotron. So I'm a high energy physicist. Before I proceed, I would like you to give you proof that I really was a fellow at St. John's College, Oxford. I'm not just saying it. Remember, it's also under oath. But now you also have a written confirmation of this. And when you become a fellow at Oxford, what most people don't know is that you don't actually get a work contract. It's still the old boys network, you know, probably just a tip on the shoulder at some point, and you just turned up. And it's very much kept like that. Of course, the entrance requirements these days, if you become a research fellow, have completely changed. So hundreds of people applied, and eventually I was selected by a panel. But you still don't have a work contract. So the only thing you get is if you request it, and only if you request it, a confirmation letter by the college office that you indeed were or are a fellow at that college. So what I will show you now is this precise confirmation that I requested before I left Oxford, just so that I can prove, you know, later on that I really was there. It was completed, or it was actually given to me on 9th of August 2012 by Joy Axtell, who was the college office head of the college office. She was the college office administrator. That's her official title. And what I did, so this is a copy of the original letter, and I'm showing you a copy because I blacked out my date of birth, and that's because it's still used by banks and other places as a password and things like that. So I don't really want to make that public, but I'll show you this letter. So this is what it looks like. That's St. John's College, Oxford here. That's their contact details, should you want to confirm this with them. And this is the date, 9th of August 2012. So you can see that was about 2 months before I left at the end of term
in 2012. So Oxford has three academic terms. And it says, this is to certify that Dr. Katherine Horton, date of birth, scrubbed out by me. Yeah. Hang on. Maybe you can see it better like that, with the paper behind, is employed as a full-time junior research fellow in physics at St. John's College, Oxford University. St. John's College, University of Oxford, for the period, can you read that? 1st of October 2008 to 30th September 2012. Stamped St. John's College, signed Joy Axtell. Okay, so you can call St. John's College and confirm that indeed I was a fellow there. And there's this, you know how we've got this rivalry between Oxford and Cambridge. And essentially, if you're at Cambridge, then they don't have junior research fellows, they just have research fellows. And if you're at Oxford, they make a distinction between, did the college pay you, or did an external grant body fund you? And if it's the college, if it's actually a college fellowship, you're a junior research fellow. And if the funding came externally, you're a senior research fellow. And, you know, traditionally there used to be just differences in seniority, but these days, really, not always. But anyway, so if you're from Cambridge, you will recognize this as the research fellowship. And the people from Oxford always have a chip on their shoulder, and some people wanted it changed so that we also, you know. So my full title was junior research fellow at St. John's College. So there we are. After that... During that time, I worked at in high energy physics. After that, did a brief project in medical physics, and then I changed to study the physics of human systems, and that's what I did for a very long time, on and off. So when I was at St. John's College, I did that for the entire last year of my fellowship, and after the end of my fellowship in 2012, I moved to Germany, where I joined my husband, who was a researcher there, and I tried to start to bootstrap a startup. And this was intended to help people get back into work, especially if it was foreigners coming into the country and not having any connections, or maybe having a different level of education, or their education certificates not being recognized. And I wanted to build a platform where these people could be integrated really quickly into the employment market, and maybe even create new jobs through that. Unfortunately, at that time, I was already being harassed, and this entire endeavor was sabotaged, systematically sabotaged. I mean, to the point where, I couldn't really continue pursuing that, especially when it's a startup and you're in a country where you haven't, I grew up in Germany, but I didn't have any business contacts there. If you're under the sort of harassment I was under, this sort of task becomes essentially impossible. So I tried for about 2 years to actually do that. And in the end, I just realized I have to give up. So I think when did I start? Well, I started, as soon as I left at the in autumn 2012, I spent a couple of months actually drawing up what I really want to do in detail. And then we moved to Munich, and that's where I really launched this thing, launched the effort. So we were there, starting in spring 2013, and I was working on this pretty much until the entirety of 2013 and 2014. And then at the end of 2014, I realized I just have to give up this endeavor. It's just impossible. And what I did then after that is that I worked in wealth management briefly. I was very interested, so I got into the physics of human systems first, and then I started this startup endeavor, trying to use my insights from systems analysis, and trying to map out how the labor market is going to develop. And then when I couldn't do that, I went back to systems analysis, and I got interested in currencies and what is happening with currencies. And then I went to a wealth management firm that was actually specializing in gold, and trying to give people, companies and so on, extra stability, actual wealth management by investing in gold. So, actual really core base, emergency backup for pension funds and for companies. So I was there very, very briefly, because after that I realized that what I really wanted to do is actually work with complex systems and think about how to improve them. So with complex systems, I mean anything, companies, big institutions. They are run these days according to principles that are still, but they are very intuitive, but they are not always very efficient. So what I did then, after that, is that I went back into studying systems analysis specifically for complex human systems. It was basically my private research project, and then we moved to Switzerland. And when we're here, I was I launched a consultancy for essentially systems analysis, or the analysis of complex human systems. And again, I was sabotaged, and then I started being assaulted in January 2016. And since January 2016, it has essentially become impossible to do my work because I'm being assaulted hourly. So, this is why I went to the court. I'm desperately trying to have this stopped. It's ongoing. In fact, the attacks on me are getting ever more insane. But I will leave that to a separate video, so you can get the details of the abuse separately.